Good afternoon. So finally we got to the almost to the end of the day, at least for when the presentations are concerned. And I have to start with the thread I had, having in mind that we will be, after the whole day of presentations of different approaches from humanities, and finally you get presentations from computer science. And it reminded me the joke I've heard, that the worst thing which may happen to anybody who enters the party or the banquet is to meet at the entrance the computer scientists, because then you will probably have to sit with him for all the night. And I would say even worst thing is to meet two of them. So I promise you I will not sit with Tomasz, with anybody with you, okay? But the truth is, I'm really a computer scientist, but for more than 20 years I'm involved in building IT infrastructure for researchers in Poland, in working from the very beginning at Poznań Supercomputing and Networking Center. And let me start with a short introduction. We founded in 1993 the center, which was supposed to provide fiber optic connectivity and high-performance computing infrastructure to researchers in Poznań, in city of Poznań, in Wielkopolska. We were affiliated to the Institute of Organic Chemistry, Polish Academy of Science, and we started in six people. Currently, PSNC has 291 employees, and we have four divisions, and we are not only serving Poznań academic community, but we are a national operator of Polish infrastructure, including research and educational network. So our activities are twofold. First of all, we operate the infrastructure in the country, starting with Polish Optical Internet PIONIER network, Metropolitan RA network, High Performance Computing Center, and data repositories, together with Digital Libraries Federation. But most of our employees are researchers and developers who participate in research projects in different areas of IT aspects, mostly suitable to domain-specific problems, or addressing domain-specific problems in research, but also in education, cultural heritage, healthcare, and many other our daily activities when IT matters actually today. So there's no actually the domain when IT doesn't nowadays. So in terms of this infrastructure, well, I'm not sure if this is visible, but maybe I will use this pointer. So we have, here's Poznań for those of you who, we are here in Warsaw. So we have in Poland 21 metropolitan RA networks, which means fiber optic networks with own fiber infrastructure connecting all research institutions, not only research but also public institutions. And all of those 21 metro networks have operators in academia. So they have all academic networks. We have five supercomputing centers also in this infrastructure. And together, 22 institutions are forming the consortium, which is called PIONIER Consortium, sharing the cost of the provisioning of this infrastructure to research community. This is quite a unique approach, I would say, in Poland, and that's why I wanted to introduce this also in this aspect of digital humanities. PIONIER itself as a network connects all those 21 metro networks, but currently we are also exchanging fibers on the road to CERN, to main road traffic exchange points in Europe, and we are now building the loop through Vienna and Prague to our network, so we are becoming more even the national network. But infrastructure, as it was designed from the beginning, was not the end of our activity, I would say, in Poland. we had a success, or we had a actually luck, I would say, that Polish government in the time at end of 90s, beginning of 21st century, got the idea to dedicate some parts of structure funds also for research infrastructure, a specific IT infrastructure for research, and deliver some over the network services to research community. And it brought a set of services within the whole community. I'm not talking about PSNC only now. I'm talking about the whole country. Like high-definition video conferencing or EduRoam access, you may know, Pioneer ID, which Tomasz mentioned, virtual firewalls, clouds for application, for databases, data preservation services like archiving on demand, or services for digital libraries, or quite interesting services like high-definition television in the internet for promoting science in Poland, also for live broadcasting. And those services, together with high-performance computing, here's an example of Poznań Supercomputing and Networking Center infrastructure, which is part of European infrastructures. This is the example of studios for providing production of interactive high-definition television programs for about science, for scientists, and for promoting scientists. Those infrastructures with services is the approach to address the needs and to overcome the barriers which we identify in particular domains, like healthcare, like, of course, science, like humanities in last years. That's why we also look for, as we already heard earlier, the programs for early adopters of different tools and projects, applications, and services which with whom we can develop them and then provide at the larger scale within the network we provide to larger community. And one of the, I think, latest examples are digital humanities. PSNC has also some laboratories to additionally provide the opportunities to manage the digitization workflows or provide the visualization and interaction tools. So it's not only the network, it's not only HPC, but for last 2 years when we got a new building, we have more than 16 different laboratories to provide the services to research community. It's not for strictly for us, it's for collaboration with researchers. One example, for instance, with the collaboration with Adam Mickiewicz University about building the annotated text corpora from medieval court judgments, which were reprinted and they are transcribed and published in a book series more than 50 years ago. And we have collaborative tasks together working on particular resource, which then we will include into our service portfolio. But the core service or core activity we've been developing for many years is the digital libraries infrastructure in Poland. And we have a platform for, currently the national platform for Polish scientific and cultural heritage resources, which is aggregated by the Federation of Services, we call it FBC. And it aggregates the content from online services with scientific or cultural heritage resources and provides the one point for searching, for dynamic linking, but also it's an entry point for Europeana. It's indexed by Google, of course, and it's linked with several other services which allows through which we allow to access those resources and reference to them. What is the important point is that this is the distributed infrastructure. So we not have the resources in one digital library or in one place. It's a full mesh of network of installations of digital library systems, with the largest one provided by National Library, then the Jagiellonian University, regional digital library in Wielkopolska, when there are more than 100 institutions contributed their content to one location. And in total, we have more than 4 million of metadata records from over 130 data sources, I mean, aggregated in FBC, of which more than 3 million is in open access. Mostly 1 million is provided by the National Library for the internal reading room in a closed access. And this is what is important for us, is to show researchers in humanities how important is to integrate their research data within such an infrastructure. We can provide within the FBC additional value coming from that integration, not only integration per se, but also services. But to explain this, we show exactly 3 or 4 pictures which will come here. So access, currently in Poland, access or estimated number of visits in FBC for 2016 will be more than 1,700,000. I mean, we have real statistics up to end of November, but monthly we have almost 200,000 visits, which are then clicked through the resources in distributed digital library infrastructure. So people are really using FBC to access digital content, and they are not doing this only once. They are returning, probably more of them finishing here, and part of them, larger part of them, is going to the resources which are distributed, as I said. We have several examples here showing that the FBC as a source of traffic for collaborating websites is on the top positions. For instance, from Wrocław University Digital Library, FBC is on the second position, and the first position is their own library network. For Digital Library of Wielkopolska, it's first position. For Digital National Museum in Warsaw, which is also connected to this infrastructure, is first position, and similar with a digital repository of research institutes. But of course, there are other important, like Wikipedia, for instance, which usually links to FBC whenever the person is mentioned or the content can be searched through FBC. Technical aspect of this infrastructure is also important. For last year, FBC is operating continuously, so we have zero downtime for last year. And what is important is also indexing, Google indexing and positioning. FBC is currently about has currently about 350,000 indexing calls or accesses from Google. So it's all day per day. So it's almost monthly traffic of FBC in indexing by Google per day. This infrastructure allowed us to expand on a European level, because we were accessing or we were providing the content to Europeana, and cloud infrastructure for Europeana, which was a project developed since 2013, was actually our contribution to Europeana. We were asked to become technological partner of Europeana, and currently we are preparing to host all the content for Europeana at our resources in PSNC on the cloud infrastructure and services we develop for them within the Europeana Digital Services Infrastructure project. This is infrastructure for larger institutions, but we found out that also some private owners came with their collections to digitize their content and put it into the research infrastructure. That's why we deployed also the service called LogCloud, and this service is in production since January 2015. It's free, and it's for the collections up to 25,000 objects. And we deployed successfully in several institutions, like, for instance, one scientific library or one local theater, for providing their archive of posters and leaflets in the theater, produced in the theater. And again, going or stepping one step above, we started also provide researchers with the tools and services which they can work with the resources with in this infrastructure. And one of this example is virtual transcription laboratory, when the free service for OCR and transcription of historical documents was provided using our high-performance computing and cloud resources to process it in the scale. So we are able to provide large-scale institutions because we have top bottom-up infrastructure. And we support this crowdsourcing-based transcription, and every researcher can do their own workspace, share the documents or the research hypothesis around the documents and work on the transcription. Other examples is Karait's digital archive, also in collaboration with Adam Mickiewicz University, when based on XML database and TEI format, we provide or we import data from MS Word or MS Access about the Karait's and provide the develop the content and repository fully integrated with VTL, with this virtual transcription laboratory. So in summary, on the one side, we started with advanced infrastructure and for communication, for hosting, for multimedia services, for long-term preservation, also with the complementary participation in European infrastructure services like JANT, EGI, EUDAT, OpenAir, and also with the integration with Europeana Cloud, collaboration with Daria. On the other hand, we have been developed a program and strategy for development, joint research projects with the domain-specific communities, advanced use case-centric services, like focus on a scalable computation or web analytics. We have some research background in semantics and knowledge platforms, allowing us also to provide individual research contribution to that project, not only IT services. Some interoperable research tools are deployed already in our network, so we focus also on the sustainable provisioning of those tools and services to our users. And of course, we have promoting, we are promoting our works through conferences, trainings, workshops, and public. And in that context, I would say that Pioneer Infrastructure is the digital humanities laboratory when researchers can come and experiment. Experiment with the content, experiment with the tools, experiment with the IT. And our role is to ensure that this experiment will be successfully transferred to the real service provided to other researchers and build the content for next challenges or overcoming existing barriers. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, and now it's time to have some questions to Cezary and to Tomasz, also the previous speaker.
I have a few questions and comments to, especially to the first speaker. The languages that were listed for as tools for programming were acutely ill-fitted to the task of dealing with text. One of the big problems is typing in those languages. They were designed to deal with things like characters, not words, and numbers. And I would recommend that you look at languages that are much easier for implementing typing, such as Julia. Another,
but, you know,
comment is that most of the tools are prepackaged and don't allow interaction of users. Again, I would recommend you look at things like Extempore, the language that a user can incorporate in real time into the running program, and the real interactivity. Another problem is that the processors used for processing text were also not created for dealing with text. So I would recommend looking at things like automata processor, which came out of Micron, currently under a very new company called Natural Intelligence Semiconductor. And another problem, of course, is with memory, because memory is addressable and not contextual. And then you have to use things like string searching in order to get to the real part of the text. So I think it's a lot of work for computer scientists and humanities experts to do a lot of work here. Thank you.
Okay, so it's hard to... Let me answer the first question, because maybe it's a misunderstanding. The idea of I agree with you, this is the problem with languages. I fully agree with you, but the idea is that we are not developing these language tools for the scratch. We are using already developed language tools. That's the problem, that they are developed as they are developed, okay? And it drives the problem. Maybe it's always the problem that when computer engineers start a problem, that the best idea is to start from the beginning, but we don't have enough resources to do it. So the idea is to put existing things together. And I agree with you that there are much more suitable languages than mentioned by me. But okay, we have to work with reality. That's the problem. And could you repeat the name of the company? Because I think it's quite interesting.
Julia, the language is Julia.
Julia, okay.
The next language is extempore.
Micron. Okay, thank you very much. Very nice comment.
Okay,
if I could.
Okay,
sorry.
So Jan.
I could wait.
I ask your question now.
I'd love to wait. Because actually, the reason why I'm sort of jumping in, because I would like to comment on the comment, because we've been working with your group on this connection between the Stylo package and your wonderful teams, and I think we were doing a horrible thing when you look at it from your point of view. That is, we've been merging together a package written for R. Now, when my colleague Maciej Eder wrote the first version of our package for R, that has become a tool that is used by stylometrists. From the very beginning, people were telling us, not a good idea. Go to... Yeah, well, I mean, in our case, it was even worse. They never mentioned that. People were saying, oh, Python's so much better, move to Python. The problem is, for the humanists, if we want to wait for something to be built from scratch, we would have nothing to work on. So it's, this is the first time, I'm a pure humanist here. I just like to count things with computers. So from my humanist point of view, of course this is the first time I hear of those possibilities, and they are very interesting. On the other hand, there is the reality that, actually we're very happy that someone like that group were interested in our little program that makes it, that allows literary scholars to actually use the computer, because obviously we will probably never have the funds, the resources, and the know-how to work on something entirely new. So obviously, I mean, if you continue in that direction, then why, I mean, just use Excel for everything. I mean, thank God it's not, it doesn't have to be that extreme. So that's the problem. Excuse me. Yeah,
sure. Any comment to this from?
One thing I forgot, that I haven't seen anybody referring to semantic web. We know about annotation of some sort, but maybe that was hidden somewhere. But I'm very interested in building predicates and building proper ontologies and annotating and building RDF type of infrastructure, this sort of thing. If someone could comment on that.
Yes, so we had actually in our common project, we had a group of activities for using digital libraries infrastructure to build the RDF triples and the knowledge infrastructure with mapping the geographical names and person names, as well as, I think, more visualization tool set also to analyze the links or the proposed links by the knowledge database we built. I don't remember numbers, but it was really a huge amount of triples, but it was like 3 years ago, and now we have it in a test version, I would say.
Okay, and another question.
I was a slightly different question. A lot of your infrastructure is geared towards having services that run, so you upload your text to Corpora, it's processed. I have a slightly different perspective in that I'm thinking in terms, in our program, we have students who learn Python in first year. So therefore, I can get them to use tools like Jupyter Notebooks to embed, to write the Python themselves, and also to document it as they go along, which is a slightly different thing in that I want to teach them how to actually write the scripts, Python or R or whatever they hook into the Jupyter Notebooks. And I think that's a different kind of approach, but it's tending towards the whole open science, documenting your process. How do you see your Clarin tools, your tools working with that kind of situation where somebody is running an open science notebook style thing for their own research? How do you see the two of those hooking in together? Is that a hard question? Sorry.
I don't know. I have it in summary thinking. Yeah. I'm not able to answer the question really, but it's inspiring, I think. But, you know, for me, it's quite important to get your needs, your understanding, because let's say computer engineers are very very closed, and I think even in the process of teaching, we are still forgetting that we as a computer engineers are developing software for somebody. So the user's needs, the user's perspective is very, very important. And I was saying that the biggest problem for us engineers, computer engineers at least, are human beings because they are not so well described. So I'm not able to answer your question, but I think it's a good question. I will think during the night, so maybe tomorrow.
So you guys, sit, spring. You guys sit together in the banquet.
But, yeah, nice.
Okay, one more question here.
I actually also had a question for Tomasz. So you were talking about user needs and user point of view as an example of top-down development, which would be completely opposite of what we in the social sciences, we would say that that's a bottom-up development.
So no, that's the problem of language we have been talking before. Mm-hmm. You know, for us, it's top because user is at the top.
So what would be then an example of a bottom-up development?
So we are starting from some algorithm and then looking for people if somebody wants to use it. Mm-hmm. And we are trying to develop some algorithms, to find some algorithms, on the other hand, to solve some real problems. And I'm developing a paper, usually I have to describe some algorithm. So so user needs are really not important from that point of view. Of researcher, let's say. Mm-hmm. So some methods, some data, and some results. It doesn't have to work really as a real tool. It doesn't have to solve some real problem, which are also quite interesting, by the way. So I'm quite happy that we have something like Clarin that help at least me as a computer engineering to go outside my shell, let's say.
Thank you.
Okay, any other questions, comments, questions to the previous speakers? We still can have one more question. Okay.
I have a question relating to PCSS. Oh, thank you. If I, as a very modest humanist, want to find out what you offer or approach you in your HPC center network with my problem, how do I approach you? I mean, I've just called up your website just to see how easily I would identify a service that is of relevance to me. It's not easy, unfortunately, because I have to click myself through a pretty long list. So I would actually want something like a broker service or a recommender service or some entry point, because your world might be very efficient and offer me a lot of interesting solutions, but I don't have a clue how to enter it.
Yes.
How do you solve that problem? And more particularly to the topic of this conference, what would the role of a DH center probably be in bridging this gap?
Yes, actually, I would say the best way to approach us is to approach us. I mean, to sit and meet. Oh, this is our.
I'll sit next to you.
Yeah. Yes. So, and of course, we have. The main point is that the services we provide are the services to our network-connected institutions. So they are included in a connectivity. That's why we have direct links to the community, which is directly using our services, to offer them extra value. And we approach them, they approach us as their network or IT operator or competence center in digital libraries or high performance computing or cloud computing. That's the way we know our community and they know us. It's not always the thing which is enough to make a collaboration, because there are some other barriers, but at least we are in touch. If we have somebody from outside our community, like for instance City Hall or a museum which is not connected to our, they probably, the easiest way is to find out how to meet us or how to make a contact. And this happened very often because the news is shared within the community. I mean, when we collaborate, for instance, with National Museum in Warsaw, other national museums access us because they get information. We have some services they might be interested in. So, but to tell you the truth, we are not very much, I would say, market focused. Yeah. So we are not too much active in promotion and having this light on our services broadly. And what we want currently to do is to find out the driving groups in the universities for building the early adopting services, and we do this with the healthcare for in silico computations or observations for personalized medicine. We do the same with media services or institutions, and the same with cultural, with the humanities.
Okay, thank you very much once again.